You're listening to the Unwritable Rant Podcast with your host, author, and occasional misanthrope, Juliette Miranda. Go to theunwritablerant.com and you can subscribe on iTunes or connect with the show on Facebook and Twitter.
Hey there, y'all. It's Juliette Miranda. This is episode number 48 of the Unwritable Rant Podcast. It is another gorgeous summer day. I've got a glass of bourbon sitting next to me, and that means I am in the mood for a toast. Don't leave me hanging, y'all. Grab a glass, let's raise them up, and let's say cheers. Oh, bourbon. You know, to be quite honest, I'm not exactly a fan of the bourbon that I'm drinking right now. I'm drinking Angel's Envy bourbon, and this was a gift from a friend of ours. It's not that this is a bad bourbon. I don't want you all to think that this is, you know, disgusting or horrible and not to drink it. Personally, for me, it's just not to my taste. And that makes me a little bit sad because it was created by the former master distiller from my beloved Woodford Reserve. I'd be more inclined to recommend this bourbon to somebody who really isn't a bourbon drinker. You know, if this is the first time you're drinking bourbon, I would absolutely suggest trying Angel's Envy. Apparently, it was aged in port barrels for a couple of months, but it has this incredibly sweet flavor to it. I mean, really, it reminds me a bit of maple syrup. You definitely get the corn flavor out of this. You know, there's kind of like a raisin flavor, kind of plum and grape. It's very fruity. It's very light. But it just, it doesn't feel like enough of a bourbon for me to really enjoy. You know, I like a good light bourbon on a summer day. Like I said, it's not that this is bad. I just feel like it's a little bit too sweet for my palate. But that's just me, y'all. And that's certainly not going to stop me from drinking it. It's bourbon, right? It can't be all bad. Besides, I'm on a bit of a tear because these past couple of weeks have been absolutely insane and crazy, and the weirdest shit has been going on. And like all good stories should, this one begins with a trail of bloody fingerprints. They were totally mine, of course. My guy found them in the kitchen, and then he followed them to the bar, to a bottle of bourbon, and then eventually to the sofa, where he found me sitting comatose with a glass of bourbon in one hand and a seeping paper towel wrapped around the other. He could really only shake his head. You know, he's seen me in a lot of moods over the past 8 years, but this was a whole new level of crazy. And I never would have thought that I would lose my mind quite like that. I mean, particularly over something as totally stupid as a power failure. It all just seemed like such a cute adventure when the power first went out. We'd been hearing warnings about this massive storm for a couple of days, and it finally rolled in on a Monday afternoon. Now, I am a huge fan of summer storms. I mean, you know, I'm that jackass out there with the video camera. You know, I mean, for this storm, I pulled my lawn chair right up to the edge of the open garage so I could sit there and watch the lightning and feel the bouncing of rain on my toes. It was gorgeous. It was a lovely, just wild and crazy night. And my guy and I are sitting there, we're watching it, we're drinking our bourbon. And all of a sudden you hear this flicker behind you and we look and the power has gone out. And we kind of roll our eyes at each other because, you know, an overweight jogger is enough to knock out the power in our townhome community. And that kind of makes ComEd just slightly better service providers than Comcast. And at the time, you know, a little bit of darkness was kind of novel. There wasn't a whole lot we could do about it, you know, so we shut the blinds. We pulled some last chance ice out of the freezer and refilled our cocktails. Not a big deal. So the storm passes, like they all do. And out of nowhere, neighbors that we didn't even know existed start staggering out of their homes like the living dead. You know, they're all looking at each other going, "Do you have any power? Do you have any power?" Now, I've had my fill of neighbors this summer. Thank you very much. So I left it up to my guy to get the scoop from them on the power situation while I hung out in the back of the garage kind of like a rabid hyena. So right around 6 p.m. or so, rumors start spreading through our little community that this is no ordinary power outage. You know, the few people who could navigate the crazy labyrinth of phone lines at ComEd, they'd learned from very tired and very cranky operators that the problem was widespread, and it was complicated in our particular area because of a car accident where some jackass had landed on the power grid. They estimated that our power would not be restored until late Wednesday. Well, this was not good news. My guy and I look at each other, and we're both just dead pale. You know, all of the benefits that we love about working from home, you know, the solitude, the comfort, the convenience, a functioning internet connection, These had all just been yanked away from us. And we're just imagining the horror of having to work from a coffee shop. Oh, I know, our lives are just so brutal and awful. I get it, believe me. But, you know, we pour ourselves another drink and we think, all right, we can handle this. So we slept on the floor in the living room that night. It was the coolest area in the house short of the bathtub because the cat had commandeered that spot for herself. And remember, this is the summer in the Midwest, in Chicago particularly, where humidity is an entity. So we're both laying there on the floor and we are dripping sweat like some sort of feverish animals. It was disgusting. We felt horrible. But, you know, we still had this little bubble of optimism in our minds. You know, we're thinking, okay, maybe, just maybe, we'll wake up and, you know, we'll have that wonderful mechanical whirr in the air that we're accustomed to. Instead, we woke up, our phones are flashing low battery warnings at us, and our electric stove was just staring at us. There would be no coffee or tea this morning. There'd just be, you know, the aches and pains that old people get from sleeping on the floor, and this kind of suspicion that we'd just been shipwrecked in our own home. So survival mode totally kicked in. I started hoarding liquor, and my guy rationed batteries. We all have our priorities. I decided to call it a personal day. My guy, he got in the car and went in search of free Wi-Fi. So I dragged a lawn chair out under a tree and just started napping a little bit. It was cooler outside than it was in our house. And, you know, I really should have known better. You know, I know that my neighborhood is full of weirdos and stalkers. So why I decided to just, you know, lay out under a tree, you know, like a goat for a Tyrannosaurus is beyond me. I don't know. I wasn't in my right mind. And of course, no sooner had I nodded off did I get jarred awake by some idiot neighbor staring down at me. You know, lady, I'm not a puppy smothering in a car. I can handle myself. But she looks down at me and she's like, so you're okay? You know, you still don't have power, right? And I'm like, oh, no, we've got power. We're fine. You're the one who doesn't have power. Well, she didn't get my joke, but whatever. I'm constantly amazed at the way people in general just kind of like band together. Not that this is a bad thing. This is a great thing in times of true crisis. But this was not a crisis. No one's house had blown down. We weren't flooded out. You know, this was just a power outage. It was a very personal and private thing as far as I was concerned. I didn't need companionship. Because y'all, my so-called Southern charm is limited at best. You know, I didn't want to hear their theories on when we'd get our power back. I didn't care that 2 pounds of liverwurst was smoldering in somebody's home. You know, unless one of these people worked for ComEd and had something truly useful to say to me, I just wanted to be left alone to my bourbon and my heat stroke. Is that too much to ask? So the temperature in our house was hovering just short of nuclear. And I knew that wasn't safe for anybody, particularly my cat. So I deposited her with my parents a few towns over. And my parents, loving as they are, they offered my guy and I their spare bedroom for a couple of days. And I love my parents, I do. And I love their working air conditioning, but I would sooner vomit blood from my eyeballs than spend a full night there. You know, no offense to them, of course. But between their bickering and my dad's theories and why Stephen Hawking is a hack, and my mother suggesting that it's not too late for me to produce a grandchild, I will take my chances in the heat. Thank you very much. Besides, adversity is always the mother of invention. My guy and I had a total stroke of inspiration when we got home, and by Wednesday morning, our house was jerry-rigged like a Tom and Jerry cartoon. We'd unearthed these power converters that could be plugged into the lighter sockets in our cars, and that gave us the ability to string a whole line of cables through the garage and up the stairs to our main level. So we got a fan blowing, we juiced up our computers while our cars were droning away in the background, which totally wasn't ideal. I mean, with both of our cars idling like that, we were likely pumping enough carbon monoxide into the neighborhood to quietly murder a few house pets. Plus, you know, the cables, they kind of tethered us to our front stoop, because it turns out that was the only area where we could plug our computers into our cars and still steal an unprotected wireless signal. And again, all of that, it would have been fine. Uncomfortable, maybe, but not a huge deal. Except that out of nowhere, we started hearing noises. Really unpleasant, droning bursts of sounds that just like ripped through us like fire. And I look up and I listen and I realize that it's somebody playing scales on a trumpet. It turns out that the offspring of our neighbor, yeah, he's a trumpet player. He's maybe, I don't know, 13 or 14. And holy crap, he might be the world's worst trumpet player on the planet. And he was practicing from the room directly above us. Well, he massacred the C major scale. And once he'd done that, he switched over to London Bridge's Falling Down, a classic in any town, really. And it was at that point when my guy and I ditched our glasses and started swilling bourbon from the bottle. Well, he rattled into the theme of Star Wars next, and he played it in such fits and starts that I never would have been able to identify it, except for the fact that his dad had just started humming along with him. And it was only fitting then that he would follow it up with taps. That crazy that I was telling you about, it kicked in. I silently got up, I went into the house, and I decided to start playing with my chef knife. I was just done. You know, I was frustrated at ComEd being so dramatically useless. You know, I was annoyed that the air mattress we'd unearthed and put in the living room had a hole in it, and that sleeping on it felt like riding the Titanic. I hated that I was out of clean clothing left to wear. And holy crap, I was so sick of peeing in the dark. You know, I'm a girl who likes her comforts. I just am. That's why I don't go camping. You know, but I felt like I was camping in my own home. You know, and peeing in the dark, that was it. You know, and I'd done it so many times that I'd randomly started cursing the Amish. You know, those Amish creeps, they just appear so pleased with themselves, you know, and their lack of electricity. You know, they toil away, they hammer nails into barn walls, they churn butter. And me, admittedly, I'd kind of spent the past hour or so trying to figure out how to hotwire my curling iron to a AA battery. Oh, I get it, y'all. I was whining. I was whining, but that's what I do sometimes. So I just directed my rage and my whining and all of that anger that I had circling around through my head. I directed it right onto the head of a lettuce that was wilting in the stagnant confines of our refrigerator. I dropped that lettuce right onto a cutting board. I slid my chef knife out of its sheath, and I just started chopping away on that thing like a 2-year-old having a tantrum, wildly and without a single goddamn care in the world. And it felt good for a couple of minutes. It felt productive. But the brilliant and terrible thing about my chef knife is just how sharp it is. I mean, that thing is so sharp, I didn't realize that I'd hacked my finger until I saw the blood mixing in with the slimy lettuce leaves. It wasn't a fatal wound. It was really only a flesh wound, superficial at best. So I patched it up with a paper towel, sat down on the couch, and waited for my guy to come find me. Well, he looks at the crazy hot mess I'd become, and he said, "Let's just get the hell out of here." See, up until that point, we'd been sticking close to home deliberately. It was mostly security, you know, with the power being out and our neighborhood being, you know, the Old West. We were a little concerned about crime, you know, theft, whatever, vandalism. So we wanted to make a show of being around. But you know what? What the hell? Let them steal our laptops. We didn't care. We decided to walk over to the cantina for a little bit of warm food and some good cold tequila. Well, that improved my mood dramatically. So we're walking out of the restaurant, but I don't really want to go home. You know, I'm not ready. It was dark out. It was feeling reasonably comfortable. And I was up for a little bit of mischief. You know, I get that way sometimes, particularly when, you know, that crazy is circling around in my eyeballs. It's that perfect apex of being drunk and needing retribution for the random stresses of my life, right? I mean, everybody gets that way sometimes. At least I like to think that they do. And I had an idea. Well, my guy was just drunk enough to be curious, but smart enough to be worried, because the last time I made that announcement, he had to prevent me from stealing a street sign. I told him not to worry, though. I was just going to do a little bit of damage. Nothing major, nothing criminal, exactly. So I grab his hand and I pull him down to the street to our local church. I've always been a little annoyed by this church. It's nothing personal. I have no clue what denomination it is. I just know that they're prone to putting these really stupid cutesy sayings on the marquee out front. You know, it's always nonsense like, anger is one letter away from danger, and, you know, why pay for GPS when Jesus gives direction for free? Does he? Does he really? Well, the sign that particular day, it read, "Everyone welcome to worship. Food for the soul has no calories." Oh, words of wisdom. Words of wisdom that were about to get rearranged into something that suited my purposes. And my guy knew what I was going to do. He knows me oh so well. And he's like, "I will have no part of this." And I go, "That's okay. Just keep watch." My guy really does make the perfect partner in crime. So he kind of, you know, hovers behind a bush, you know, keeping watch out for people walking by. But it was a very quiet, dead night. Half the streetlights were out anyway, so nobody could see what I was doing. It was fine. Pulled all the letters off of that sign. And by the way, this was a low sign. It's not like I had to climb up on any buildings to get at it. So I yank all those letters off. I scatter them on the ground. And I pull out real quick the ones that I want, throw them up on the sign, and stand back to admire my own personal words of wisdom for the community. F you, com ed. Oh, it was brilliant. It was beautiful. I was so proud of myself. Well, my guy and I tear out of there because, of course, we don't want to stick around the scene of the crime. So we go home, and I slept great. I mean, it's that really contented sleep that, you know, only those who lack any remorse experience. And it was divine. Well, Thursday morning, we wake up, and of course, no power, nothing. And we stagger out onto our front, you know, driveway, and we're looking around. And the neighborhood is on the fringe of feral. You know, what had been friendly greetings and concern about the well-being of the neighborhood? Yeah, that was all out the window. Now it was replaced by seething assessment. And we were doing it too. It was weird. I mean, all of a sudden, Lord of the Flies rules applied. You know, we're eyeballing our neighbors and people are eyeballing us. You know, we're looking around and we're like, ooh, does he have a generator? Is that a refrigerator running in the garage? We're thinking like thieves and maniacs now. The community had just become so primitive that it would not have surprised me to find a boar's head on a spear and men running around hunting rabbits in the common areas. I mean, it was half there already. You know, we have this community barbecue pit. Well, it was controlled by this gang of rogue soccer dads who were these complete dickheads. You know, if you didn't bring your own charcoal, if you didn't bring your own meat, they weren't going to let you use that grill. There was a communal car wash area. Yeah, that had been taken over by unmerciful children. They wielded that hose like a horse whip. You walk past him and then you are getting blasted with water. And I'll tell you, they were going to be the first ones I was taken out. Oh yeah, I started thinking that way. And I wasn't the only one. There was a couple down the street, they nearly came to blows over a bag of ice. So much for that common good. And then, between all of the clawing and the cannibalism and the looting, out of nowhere, you could hear that current just clicking on. Someone had finally flipped our switch, and the neighborhood was alive with a magical spark of electricity once again. Well, normalcy took hold quicker than penicillin. You know, all of a sudden, you start to hear air conditionings kicking on. You know, you hear people turning on their washing machines, you know, agitating 4 days of sweat and grime out of their clothing. And we all just kind of walk into our homes as if nothing had happened. And I'll tell you something. Somewhere, I know the Amish were laughing at us. I need some bourbon. Hang on. Oh, nothing like bourbon. Well, y'all, I think you've heard enough out of me. I've got a beautiful summer day outside. I've got electricity. I'm not feeling all that crazy, so I think it's going to be a pretty good day. In the meantime, I want to remind you all, I am still looking for a tattoo artist in Chicago. I've gotten a couple of recommendations, but nobody that I'm quite comfortable with yet. So please hit me up on Twitter. I'm Juliette Miranda at Morning Neurosis on Twitter, or you can go to my website, which is theunwritablerant.com. You can find me through there. However you want, just let me know. Tattoo guy, please. And if you're so inclined, find me on iTunes. Leave me a little bit of a rate and review. I'd love to hear from you, and I would really appreciate the input. So that's all, folks. Have a great week. I'll chat again with you next week. Cheers, y'all.